Hello everyone, it's with great pleasure and joy to welcome back. You probably remember, some of you may remember, they left within the last 5 years. You can recognise them. Rolls Royce and Matt Coxon and Cowboy. Doug Thurse was born in 2012. Doug Thurse is an expanded four magazine and artist conglomerate. Doug Thurse works with an international rotating assemblages of artists, musicians, writers, and cartoonists to produce an annual publication. Doug Thurse is distributed throughout Europe and the USA. Recent live events include Doug Thurse Issue 3 launch party at Golden Grill Kebabs, Haters Gonna Fate at the ICA, and Doug Thurse Issue 4 launch party at super exclusive secret East London warehouse location. Doug Thurse is very real. Welcome, Doug Thurse.
Hello everyone, it's Wednesday, January 13th, 2016. Our name is Darth Thurst and we're here to talk to you about ourselves. We're very happy to be here today at the Slade School of Fine Art, particularly because it is our alma mater, as the Americans say. Feels good to be home, baby. Feels good to be home. College is super fun and we're super glad that the lousy dean let us come back, even though we used to pull hella pranks all the time. We are particularly happy that we are being paid a total sum of £160 for our talk today, which, divided by the three members of Darth Thurst, equates to £53.30 each. Ka-chang, you la la yeah, BBHMM. Back in our day, university fees were a mere £3,000. Thank you, Mr. Blair, and so it feels especially good to return here with a less significant debt of £2,946.70. Actually, that doesn't even make sense because it was £3,000 a year and we were either here for 3 or 4 years depending on who you ask, so if my calculations are correct it would be more like £9,000 or £12,000 LMAO, whoops, so actually we are totally fucked, am I right, ladies? But not as fucked as you lot. Don't worry though, we're here to help. Before we begin, we would first like to pay respect to this blessed day. January 13th isn't just a day when we've come to talk to you, it is also the birthday of some of our best friends. So without further ado, and in no particular order, we would like to say happy birthday to the following: Julia Louis-Dreyfus, Marinus van der Lubbe, Liam Hemsworth, Katie Brand, Paul McCarthy, no, not that one, Matthew Bourne, Michael Penner, Orlando Bloom, and so on. They are here with us in spirit. What our humble audience is probably wondering more than anything right now is, who are Darth Thurst? What are they doing here? If they went to a British uni, how come they have this really ripper Australian accent? Oh, struth, well you no good pommy bastards, it's time to learn a thing or two about real life in the bush. So sit back and sip on your ice cold dinny of good old Foster's, throw another shrimp on the barbie and let's start learning about a little thing we like to call doing art. Where to begin? Summer of 2012, what a time it was. We were all very, very young then. We emerged blinking into the sun, covered in amniotic fluid and our mother's feces. Then all of a sudden, the fine art media department at the Slade School of Fine Art, shouting out to the major homies, one love to you, were like, what's poppin'? Your project fund money application is the best thing we have ever seen. You newborns with your open fontanelles look like you'd be great at putting together a magazine about work by snot-nosed art students, and we were all like, wow, that is so flattering. We really appreciate it. Our grasp of language, graphic design, critical theory, printing processes etc. is quite limited, but we'll give it a go. If you believe in us. As the Germans say,
man's lebt nur einmal.
And so we set to work. Okay, right, so basically the deal with issue one was that it was a family affair. Everyone in the mag was from the Slade School of Fine Art Media Department, except for someone's dad, who was in it as well, lol, because he's famous. Don't try to guess who it is because you won't be able to. He's just that famous. Anyway, the point is that everyone had the chance to express themselves, super famous or not. Was this a good thing? Maybe. Was this the way it was? Yes. Is this the way it is in the real world, as a real girl? Not likely. But these were splendid days of laughter, sunshine, and project fund money. How could we have known any better? So we got on with our work, lost some fingers in the printing press, and dreamt of making a good change in this crazy world. Could it be done? By us, I mean. We printed the thing on recycled paper with soya-based ink or some bullshit. I'd like to give the world a Coke, and all the jazz. Is something good just because we care enough? After finishing issue one, we turned around and were like, God damn, this is a huge pile of shit. Why did we even bother? FML, so we dealt with it the only way we knew how. Roll film, please. R.I.P. Pour one out for the homies. Anyway, after we destroyed the only known copy of issue one, it was time to throw off the shackles of our insecurities and take control of our lives. What did we learn? What did we have to gain? Well, literally all we had gained was some experience in independent publishing, and a small wad of sweet, sweet cash from flaunting our wares in various ye olde bookshops and artistic galleries. So what was there to do? Invest it maybe. Pension planning, retirement home. Remember, we are still very arrogant and young, with no concept of our own mortality. It was only 2013 by this point, so we said to hell with this. Let's do issue two. And what an issue it was. I remember it like it was yesterday. So for issue two, because we were young children, we were like, okay, well, we really like delicious candy and stickers, so we were like, OMFG, let's actually just put candy and stickers actually in the magazine, because YOLO. Remember, this was 2013, so everyone was still really into saying YOLO all the time. It sounded like a trendsetting idea, one that would pioneer generations to come. As well as doing that, we were like, KMT, okay, well, I guess we should put actual art in here. What a giant drag. But after throwing a huge tantrum about it, we were like, okay, control yourself. It's time to grow up. So we hit up some mega cool artists who are super successful, as well as asking our dumb friends. In the end, there were some cool real artists in issue two, like Ed Fornils, Mark Titner, Plastic Fantastique, and Alastair McGinvin. Also, much to our surprise, some of our stupid fucking friends who we hate have actually become successful after being featured in issue two. God damn it, are you serious? Like, have you heard of Matthew Parkin? He's a snapchatting homosexual who totally has a solo show at IMT Gallery next year, like WTAF. And Sasha Litvinseva, originally a prostitute from Russia, is now officially a professional video artist showing art videos and video festivals all over the Videodrome. And maybe most famous of all, if you're cool enough, is A.G. Cook, who is surprisingly not in the culinary business, doesn't have any Michelin stars and isn't a famous celeb chef. No, he is in fact a pop star who like wrote us a poem and also like made us a cute web animation whatever thing. Pretty cool, right guys? Don't be jealous of our YMCMB swag. Also, we had some other people in issue 2 who haven't made it as artists yet. Not our fault, guys. Take responsibility for yourself. Or just submit next time, shrug lol. Anyway, here's a read-through of the mag. She's a squirter. Okay, right, so we made issue 2, which was really fun and exciting. But something even more fun and exciting happened afterwards, at the launch party. Right, so who's the most famous person you can think of? Think really hard. Don't share your answer, but just keep it in mind. The correct answer is, of course, drum roll please, Jude Law. Can you believe it? We couldn't either. He had come especially to our magazine launch party, to see us. Wow, we thought to ourselves, we've really made it this time. Maybe we can be his concubine, or something. Anyway, so Jude was all about our thirst, no treble. But goddammit, how were we going to remain the apple of his eye, the fruit of his loom? With Jude Law going absolutely ham sandwich over issue 2, we decided to give him, and the world, what they wanted, the third issue. But what could we do? We'd made a normal magazine. We'd made a normal magazine and put it in a bag. We were at the height of our innovative powers. What was left for us to do? What more could we offer? After a meeting with Jude, and an X-rated four-way reenactment of his hit box office smash Alfie, we asked the great sage for his advice on creating a smash hit of our own, Darth Thirst issue 3. You won't believe what he said next. This is a verbatim quote.
Okay, right. So with this issue you need to start thinking outside the box. Do you remember my turn in David O. Russell's I Heart Huckabees? That was a guy who was a very certain kind of guy, and really had his world shaken up. Perhaps you could approach your third issue in a similar way? Consider both the format of your magazine, and the way your contributors react to that format. Why not expand the thirst, so it isn't only on the printed page, but also in digital format? Like remembering Contagion when I played the guy who uses both printed matter and online platforms to spread conspiracy theories about that virus. Remember that virus? It messed Gwyneth Paltrow up real bad lol. That's what you get for cheating on Matt Damon, though. Like, seriously. Do you remember that time that he beat me to death with an oar in The Talented Mr. Ripley? Boy, did I have a headache that day. Anyway, why don't you guys think about harnessing more control over what your contributors submit to you, while simultaneously widening the ways in which they can make work? This could be especially interesting given current debates concerning the nature of bookmaking, and whether traditional print publishing can work in harmony with methods of electronic publishing that are still being established, albeit in a primarily corporate, monetized sphere. Producing a magazine that existed as a limited edition, pleasing digital object as well as including exclusive digital artworks by up-and-coming and established artists could really put you ahead in the game. But don't ask me, lol, I'm just an actor.
End quote. We were like, whatever, Jude, maybe you should stick to what you do best, acting. We don't need your help. But as we tried to sleep that very night, we pondered to ourselves, maybe that good-looking son of a gun had the right idea. Maybe we could take influence from his many fantastic feature films and make something that was both a physical magazine and a digital artwork. But how? Stirring out of our restless slumber, we took a midnight stroll around Camberwell, the renowned hub of inspiration for Britain's most talented artists. It was a dark night, the metal shutters on the shops pulled down to protect their juicy innards. There was a lone light shining, a North Star, a beacon, a slim green opening, a slit nestled between an all-you-can-eat Chinese, and a pub that has board games, the Golden Grill. We made our way in, suddenly ravenous, hunger for something more than just food and more than just art. Then it came to us, what if, we took Jude's idea of digital and print as a prototype, but then added a third kind of heat, most specifically, the heat emanating from the glorious spinning chode of the kebab wheel, the meats, the sauces, the salads. We could include a custom engraved USB stick as our USP. We could have it all, and a bag of chips. Not a kebab, not a magazine, but a kebabazine. Abra kebab bra. And the spell was cast. Issue 3 was go. But things, as ever, are not as simple as they may appear. A really important part of issue 3 was getting people to do as we say. This included giving strict instructions on titles, dimensions, media, etc., and it also helped us to more easily filter through the horrific, steaming piles of literal dog shit we had been sent under the guise of art for previous issues. We're all friends and artists here, so you'll already know this. Artists are stubborn AF, and think what they are doing is super duper important. They are like,
my practice concerns melding the spheres of sound, light and objects to produce a thoughtful critique on the modern condition in our saturated world of existence. My influences include music, film, books, art, food, and being alive.
And we're all like, lol, okay, if you say so. You know that doesn't mean anything, right? But anyway, can you do a drawing of a smiling cat for us? And they are like,
what you're asking me to do is sacrilege, to compromise my artistic practice, and by extension my very being. How dare you, sir? Do not darken my doorway again. I bid you good day.
And then we're all like, Lmao, okay, if you say so. Keep changing the world with your static noise and abstract watercolors. See if we care. Seriously though, folks, this was an interesting exercise for both us and our contributors. For example, our good pal and Turner Prize nominated artist Mark Titner loves using words in his art. He bloody loves it. So we were all like, Lmao, send us something with no words, and he only went and smacked it out the park. Good on you, Mark. What a talented fellow. Another person who did a real stand-up job was our friend and fellow Slade graduate, Benedict Drew. You may know his artwork from staring absent-mindedly into space while going up or down an escalator on the trusty London Underground. Anyway, before he was Boris Johnson's cultural partner in crime, lol, JK, we asked him to record us a voicemail message to be featured in issue 3. This was a particularly tough ask for him, because he is a new media kind of guy and voicemail messages are like so 20th century, lol. Let's have a listen, shall we?
Hello?
After all our hard work, all that was left to do was fill our pages and clog our arteries with the sweetest of kebabby meats and juices. Drool. I'm salivating just thinking about it. Do you all have a cafeteria near here? We need to get our meat fix. Roll film, please. Projectionist.
Yeah, £18.60, yeah.
Hi.
Hi, how are you? Good evening.
One kebab, please.
Yeah. Which kebab would you like? Chicken or lamb?
Chicken, please.
Chicken, yeah. Okay. Would you like in the wrap? In the wrap, yeah. Okay, no problem. All right, you guys.
Okay.
Would you like any chili or garlic, my friend?
Both, please.
Both, please. No problem. Okay. What salad would you like? Everything on it?
Yes, please.
All right, mate. No problem. Wrap, yeah?
Yes,
would you like to eat it now or take it home?
Have it, please.
Have it now, yeah?
Yes,
all right, no problem. It's gonna be easy to have it. Oh, ready to eat. That's right. Mate,
thanks
okay.
Very much.
You're welcome.
We ate it. We ate it all. And once we started to eat, we couldn't stop. It was like that girl in that book who swells up real big like a big round beach ball. And everyone's like, God damn how that girl get that fat, and she's like, do what I want, mate. Do what I want. And everyone else is like, SMH, okay, it's your funeral. Needless to say, after finishing issue 3, we were hauling some major paunch. Serious sausage fingers. Everyone was like, that's no moon, that's Darthurst. And, Darthurst is so fat she thinks only using Apple products counts as going on a diet. That's a burn right there. Ha ha ha, you're very kind, we're here all week. Anyway, it was time for issue 4, and also time to lose some dead weight. Cast off the shackles, you know what I mean. We had tried so hard to control ourselves with issue 3, that when we had the first bite of that sweet sweet kebabazine all we could say was more, more, more. Once you pop you just can't stop. A moment on the lips, a lifetime on the hips, and so on, and so forth. It was time to embrace who we truly were. Big and beautiful, loud and proud. An important part of being big, beautiful, loud, and proud, is making sure you get your whole. You know, all action at the pump stations. Straight up fucking with wild abandon. Like all up in the mouth, cunt, ear. That one really big, open pore you have that won't close up no matter what you do. And you start poking at it with a needle or some dumb shit and it only gets worse. But it's kind of satisfying to mutilate yourself slightly so you can pop out some of that sweet sticky icky pus. Anyway, after getting super chunko it really was time for our sexual awakening. What do you do before you start banging? Apart from waxing all the hair off your body, pretending you don't shit and gargling acid to get that sparkly fresh, halitosis free talk hole, foreplay, a B. So to prep ourselves for a really good seeing to, we asked all our arty pals to send us their best foreplay pics. OFC when we said for people to submit their artwork based on the premise of foreplay, we were in fact being rather clever. Allow me to demonstrate. The word foreplay can be cut down into two halves, the fore and the play. As this is issue 4, that is what the fore refers to. As for the play, I mean it could be anything, like playing a game, or a play like Will Shakespeare vibes. This kind of ambiguity can be helpful to an audience, as it offers multiple ways in which to interpret an artwork. The more you know. But anyway, we actually got a whole load of stuff that wasn't just about finger banging. What could have become a one-liner about sex, actually became a complex publication that was concerned primarily with narrative structures and processes, showcasing work from a host of international artists like Jamie and Julia Novillani, Marie Jacoti, Peter Davis, and Horrible Jiff. Issue 4 of Darthurst is a weighty tome that sets a standard for contemporary independent publishing. Can I get an amen? Don't worry though, we also got sent a scan of someone's dick. Likely put it in a scanner. Set the DPI to 300 and pressed scan. Don't worry though, cheese dick fans. He obviously didn't wash it first, like you can see a little piece of gravel under his fetid bowel sack. I mean, welcome to the vomitorium, population me. The worst thing was that we totally opened the picture in a public place. Like, so embarrassing. Anyone who was looking at our screen when that happened would have been like, you OMG, that artist conglomerate is so vile. I can't believe they get themselves off to cheesy gravel dick. We would like to take this opportunity to clarify that we, Dar Thirst, do not masturbate to Gungi's canned peen. We are, on the contrary, exclusively about bad CGI animations of zombie breeding parties, where human women are impregnated with undead babies that then eat their way out. Cut me off a slice of that sweet pie. I digress. We love issue 4. It looks great, and there are loads of great people in it. I know we've been joking around with our read-through videos, it's kinda our shtick. This time it's just a straight read-through, no funny business. Here's the mag, press play.
I don't wanna hurt you, but I'm about to work you. Watch your mouth drop real loud. I'm turning you up, I'm burning the clutch. Full speed, both feet to the floor. Feet to the floor. DJ running that back once more. Time to party, that's all I know. Grab somebody, tell them baby, 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 let's go.
Oh my god, did you see it go up like that? Oh, the humanity. What a waste. What caused the magazine to spontaneously combust like that? What an extraordinary phenomenon. Maybe the world wasn't ready. She burned too bright, flew too close to the sun. My God, sometimes a normal person is lucky enough to get close to that kind of passion, that kind of fire. With talent like that, someone always has to get burned, always has to get lost along the way. A moment of silence, please. Okay, so that's enough silence for now. I know you guys are getting restless. You, in the fifth row, you hate this, don't you? You think we are literally human garbage. You think we are simply trash, rancid swine who are wasting your time with their frivolous art practice and irreverent presentation style. Well, let me tell you something. Garbage harbors microorganisms, and microorganisms have feelings too. You think we don't also bleed, that we don't also love to enjoy ourselves, to let loose sometimes. We're not just work machines. Let us show you how good we are at having a good time. Everyone sit down and shut the front door while we play pass the goddamn parcel. This is a very easy game. I mean, I know you are dumb art students, but it's not rocket science, lol. You should know the rules. Pass the parcel. Open it when the music stops. I mean, it's pretty self-explanatory. It's literally a game for children. Alright, big shots. It's time to duel.
Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly, I'm not half the man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, yesterday came suddenly.
The game is over. Congratulations if you won a prize. Commiserations if not. Better luck next time. So I guess you are sitting here thinking, alright, so they make a magazine. So what? I didn't go to art school because I want to read. I went to art school so I could go to the best part, is where everyone is banging each other like crazy, getting super drunk, wasted, and making a fool of themselves. Where I end up in a spiral of self-hatred so visceral that I simply cannot do anything productive and waste thousands of pounds. Well, don't worry, friends, we've got your back. In January 2015, we met up with our cool friends at the ICA, aka the Institute of Contemporary Arts, aka the Institutional Critique Academy, aka the Internal Coming Association, and said to them, yo, what's up, guys? We want to throw a proper Aussie party with lots of barbecues and casual racism. Sounds good, right? And they looked upon it, and it was good. So we put on a great little party with lots of great stuff happening. In case you all didn't know, the ICA totally has a theatre space as well as its myriad cavernous gallery spaces. They were all like to us, use the theatre space, you do you, boo. And we were like, okay. You'll never guess what happened next. We thought, wait, guys, but we're not putting on a play. How can we use the theatre space if we're not putting on a play? Then it hit us. Why not take the theatre space and manipulate it so it appears to be something totally different, to transport people to another time and place by using our imaginations and some well-placed props? Slap my ass and call me Brecht. We had something. We explained this very cutting-edge and innovative idea to some good pals of ours to see if they wanted to get down and dirty avant-garde style. They were all like, yuck, hey, why not, lol. After much soul-searching and so on, we settled on a name for our precious event, Haters Gonna Fate. We were like, do you know what, lol, we have enough haters to fill Wembley Stadium. We might as well throw a big shindig in their honour. But seriously, folks, it was great. As a fate, we encouraged our stall holders to reinterpret classics that you might find in your provincial hometown at the church summer fair. So like, we asked Slade Lad graduate James Lincoln to make a coconut shy, but like with paint instead, because art. We also had feminine good friend Liv Fontaine do a puppet show, but like she was the puppet herself, plot twist. Someone's famous dad was there as well, being worked to the bone doing caricatures for hours on end, lol. One woman cried because the drawing of her was too mean, lol. If you don't want to get burned, step out of the fiery pits of hell. Long story short, it was really fun. Like so much fun. As Owl City featuring Carly Rae Jepsen taught us, it's always a good time. After the show, as they say, is the after party. We had a great little boogie with all our good pals, dancing the night away to chart-topping tracks from some of 2015's leading beat combos. We even got former Slade student Charlie XCX to DJ for us. If you're not familiar with Charlie Zuva, she studied in the painting department before deciding to pack it in and become a platinum-selling pop star, with worldwide hits such as Fancy with Iggy Azalea, and Boom Clap from the Fault in Our Stars soundtrack. As Slade students and graduates, Charlie's great success gives hope to us all. If the art thing doesn't work out, we can all just be critically acclaimed pop stars instead. As we reach the end of this talk, y'all are probably sitting back like, OMFG, this is incredible. Are you guys serious? What a career. You might as well stop right now and retire with your riches back from whence you came, or whatever. Well, let me tell you, there's no rest for the wicked, ha ha ha. In just a few days, Darth Thirst is going up to Newcastle upon Tyne to take part in Figure 3 at Baltic 39. Can you fucking believe it? It's very exciting. Apparently Cheryl Fernandez Versini is going to stop by. I know, right? We're going to be pretending to be famous, presenting a whole 5 days of video art, game shows, interviews and performances. Isn't that the most incredible thing you've ever heard? It doesn't stop there. Basically, guys, we're all good friends now. You've got to know us pretty well over the past hour. So, how would you feel about sending your old pals Darthurst some of your video work? We know you guys are making good stuff. Don't be shy. Email us on thirsty@darthurst.co.united with all your fabulous videos. We're waiting. We were going to say no questions here, please, but as this is a special occasion, we will now answer a few questions that you might want to ask. Please bear in mind that as graduates of the Slade School of Fine Art, we have probably collectively seen more contemporary art lectures than all of you here, except maybe Andy Lowell. So please believe us when we say that we know what kind of questions y'all are gonna ask. There's always someone who hasn't been listening. Save everyone's sanity by not asking a question we covered in the first 5 minutes of the talk. There's always an alpha male who wants to exert their intellectual authority, like congratulations, you've managed to interpret the great complexities of Greenberg. Spoiler alert, flat things hang better on the wall, lol. There's always someone who doesn't care what the talk was about and just wants to talk about themselves. Newsflash, Hot shot, that's our job today, so give us a freaking break. We know what we're doing, okay? Look at me, look at me. I am the captain now. Here are a selection of questions that you might want to ask. Question 1. What Slade tutor did you fancy the most? Peter Davies, obviously. Such a YBA painting thought. One love to you, P. Diddy. You'll know what I'm talking about. Question 2. Have you ever given a blowjob to a famous art-related person? Well, this is a difficult question. There are some people we may have fellated that are not art famous yet, but shall be art famous one day. There are some people who we may have fellated who are already art famous. One of us shared a strawberry yogurt with cherry salts once. Does that count? Question 3. What's the secret to your success? Portion control and exercise. Question 4. Are you guys feminists? I'm sorry. This is actually really offensive. You should be asking, are you girls feminine in 9-inch ninin manana iPod ninano niminin in nimrododin 9-inninists? The answer to that is portion control and exercise. Thanks for noticing. Question 5. If you had the option of adopting a baby fox or a baby koala, which one would you choose? That's an excellent question. You obviously know our work very well, but the answer would be too complex to go into properly in the allotted time. Maybe come up afterwards and we can discuss in more detail. Question 6. Where is Darthirst stocked? Oh fuck. We completely forgot to cover this. Our bad. The mag is stocked in many reputable art galleries and bookshops. That is Tate Modern, the ICA, South London Gallery, New Museum NYC, Printed Matter, Good Press Glasgow, and so on. You can also buy copies of issue 3 and 4 via our online internet website. We're only stocked in Europe and North America currently because we are West-centric scum. Question 7. Real jeans or jeggings? It depends what the occasion is and what kind of vibe you're after, obviously. For lounging around the house, jeggings for sure. You don't want a jeans button digging into the soft flab of your belly. But if your ass looks good packed up in real denim, why not? It's a complex issue. Question 8. To what extent do you owe your success thus far to contemporary modes of production and communication? It could surely be argued that your accomplishments are more than partially a result of using email and social media platforms to promote yourselves. Furthermore, you were able to create a professional-looking publication by virtue of user-friendly desktop publishing software and relatively affordable computer hardware. While you may be influenced in part by the underground comics movement and culture, Darthirst and other London-based independent publishers / magazines are able, through the internet, to extend beyond their immediate, physical community. Indeed, Darthirst exists in a rather saturated market of young, hip magazine makers with an Instagram presence. Is there a point to Darthirst? A point that transcends the comparative ease of both its production and distribution. What makes you different from these myriad other publications? Or are you just a walking-in joke with an internet connection? Well, fuck, way to rain on our parade. But you're not wrong, we have been able to achieve a lot more a lot faster because we can contact people so much more easily. Hasn't everyone? This kind of question, particularly aimed at artists in their 20s, is moot. It goes without saying. To paraphrase the late great Jerry Seinfeld, what is the deal with email? The answer being, ignoring for a second its complex socio-technological genealogy, not that much. Sure we use email, sure we use Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We don't use LinkedIn, lol, are you kidding? But healthy, meaning frequent and girthy, social media activity does not an interesting or relevant publication make. You're cool enough to have a friend at Daisy Digital who will claim in less than 400 words that your new poorly curated, self-indulgent, risograft atrocity is super relevant and cutting edge. Good for you. Your free, photocopied zine that fearlessly blends the oh-so-unblendable worlds of words and pictures has thousands of followers on Instagram, and you sit on your phone all day liking every single post made under hashtag creativity. Good for you. And don't forget to take your vitamin D supplements. Our quote, unquote privileged access to relevant software and hardware that lets us produce Darthirst magazine can certainly be discussed concurrently with self-promotion via social media. To reiterate on this point, a cracked version of the Adobe CS5 Master Collection doesn't a good art practice make. Nevertheless, to quote Nietzsche, upon his impending blindness and switch to the newly invented typewriter, Our writing tools are also working on our thoughts. In other words, while we are not consciously making a publication about publishing practices per se, these modes of production surely influence the final product. Indeed, we see this happen with the submissions we receive. Younger artists in particular are inclined to send artwork that is blighted with Tumblr and Photoshopitis. These submissions are not only aesthetically derivative, we give them an excessively drop-shadowed pink slime text and ironic Facebook thumbs down, but short-sighted in terms of format. 72 dpi screenshots from your iPhone 6 often don't translate well to the cheaply printed page. We're not Richard Prince, lol. This also highlights a problem with technological homogeneity. If we are indeed living in McLuhan's global village, with instantaneous exchange of information facilitated through electronic networks, then we as villagers are not merely friends and neighbors, the global village is inbred. We are trapped, left to our devices. Creating the same thing and performing the same exchanges over and again isn't practice makes perfect. It's stupid, it's lazy, it's mutations aren't evolution but regression. So, what's the difference between me and you? Dar thirst is very real. We definitely are an in-joke, but what was ever wrong with that? We would always rather be in on the joke. Are we good or better than our contemporaries in independent publishing? Who is to say? We've just got to loud mouth and like pushing buttons. What probably differentiates us the most is our strive to embrace entropy and change. We call ourselves a magazine, but within that we'll do anything. We take what we're given and roll with it. Deal with it. Question 9. If you were forced to open a bakery, what would you name it?
Monsieur Mixalos Petite Pâtisserie, 20e arrondissement, Paris, France. Sus ma bite. Omelette du fromage. Bon weekend.
I think that's all the questions we have time for today. Once again, we would like to thank you for being such a gracious audience. Are you not entertained? If you're hungry, or thirsty, as it were, for more, you can part with your sweet cash for a fresh copy of issue 4 after the talk. We probably also have a card reader with us, so no excuses, you cheap fucks. Only kidding. Learn to take a joke for once. You guys are so uptight. Anyway, I digress. It's time to say goodbye. As they say on the MTV Cribs, you don't have to go home, but you have to get the hell out of here. See you next time, smiley face.